What is a Native person? This is always a hard part of talking about my story or other Native people's stories, is what is a Native person? We are inundated with all of these images. Less so now, but things that still exist, things that affect the way that we communicate, the way that we see, the way that we perceive. Because Native people exist within the realm of the perspective of our existence and not the reality of our existence. When I was a kid, it was things like this, the Looney Tunes that were showing in weird, colorful ways how much we don't matter. And what exists in plain sight, which is our invisibility. But oftentimes it has also been something like this, a German man with paint on his face, or a sexualized figure in Disney. The original Pocahontas was about 10, 12 years old, and arguably the first sex trafficked Native person. And everything usually amounts to like white men with paint on their faces. White men with paint on their faces. This is called a corpse tag. This is real. I actually found this on eBay. You can't buy Holocaust artifacts or Nazi paraphernalia on eBay, but you can buy this. These were used by bounty hunters in the 1800s to hunt down and to murder Native people. This is like an actual artifact that proves that there's a concerted effort not just to eliminate Native people, but a concerted effort to eliminate an entire continent of people as dictated by the government of the United States. As an artist, I've had an opportunity to create a lot of different things. I did this piece using those corpse tags. It's called These Things Happened. And it's about the way that the history of our people and the way that Native people were often hunted down and were killed have just sort of been omitted from history. That instead of understanding and knowing this, we understand and know Looney Tunes and Johnny Depp and John Wayne. I want to give you guys a little bit of context before we really jump into some of the stories. I'm an artist, a contemporary artist. I happen to be Native, so that ends up being sort of my perspective. And I create work that makes sense to me in the way that I'm seeing the world through, I guess, Indigenous eyes, as a human being that is having, well, you know what? I'm a Native person having an American experience. So I do performance art. This is called the Invisible Loss Movement. And it is informed by powwow culture, except I stripped out all of the color out of the outfits, something that helps animate the movement that happens in the dances. And we eliminated the music, so you can't hear the music. It's just me and my oldest child, Sage, dancing. But even though we're all wearing black, we have black beadwork and black ribbon work and black leather work, and everything is black on black, but we're in the sunlight, but it's still like a silhouette. It's a metaphor. Like we exist, but we don't exist. We're here, but we're not here. We're visible, but we're invisible. And I work within these spaces that are meant to sometimes push buttons, sometimes make fun of you, sometimes have some fun. But all of the work ends up sort of being in this space of looking at America and the way that America views Native people. This is from a series of works where I've reappropriated old comic book images from the 40s and 50s and replaced the dialogue with lyrics from punk rock songs that sound like an Indigenous struggle. The one on the right is from a Black Flag song called Nervous Breakdown. I want to apologize for acting out of line. You see the way I am, you can leave at time. This is from a special song called If You Have a Racist Friend. And it's some sound advice. If you have a racist friend, now is the time for our friendship to end. But it's about textiles, and it's about imagery, and it's about abstraction. This is a piece called The Place Where Spirits Get Eaten. It's about American boarding schools and the weaponizing of chairs and schools to force assimilate children in a place and in a position where it is about eliminating their culture. The boarding school mantra was, kill the Indian, save the man. And it was this other concerted effort. On the piece are some braids. There's a version of it in the gallery here. My oldest kid, Sage, and my oldest son, Phoenix, we cut our hair last year for these works. But it's also about reimagining space. These textile images have existed for thousands of years, and they continue to exist, and I can work through them in a way that allows it to come out in new places and in new ways. This piece is 25 feet long and 8 feet tall. It's called Never Forget. It uses matte black paint that literally absorbs light, and what it does is it just exists in the space. The pictures are kind of hard, but what it is images that come from the Americanized idea of what we are, and the concept of Never Forget is about the way that this country and its government and its citizens have treated Native people in history and in popular culture, and how often we're told that that happened a long time ago, so get over it. But every 9/11, they always remind us to never forget. This piece is called Vehicular Dreamcatch. As a Native person, as somebody whose family is from these areas, from this country, and have been here for thousands and thousands of years, we're outwardly concerned about all these white people that are sleeping in their cars. You should be paying attention to the road, not hanging these things in your car. What are you doing? This work is my voice. This work is all that I have. This work is always going to be all that I have. This is my life's work. And I feel lucky and privileged to have that. There's this idea in our communities that artists are like medicine people, that they carry magic with them, that there's an element or a semblance of healing that's attached to the things that we're doing and the way in which we're doing it. This is an 80-foot-tall mural in downtown Colorado Springs. Colorado Springs is the second most politically conservative city in the country, and somehow I managed to put an 80-foot portrait of a Native person. It's actually Sage. And it is about missing and murdered Indigenous relatives, this epidemic that's happening as with a handprint over their faces. But it's also very much about representation, because Sage didn't want to put their hair up in braids and didn't want to wear buckskin or ribbon dress, just wanted to wear their favorite t-shirt for their favorite punk band. And that is just as Native as anything else. It's really interesting having the ability to make these things and having access to these things, and it makes me think about how I got here. Music was a huge part of my household and part of my life. And to me, the thing that made the most sense was this music, this punk rock music. But there's this old chicken and the egg thing, right? Like, do I listen to punk rock because I'm angry, or am I angry because I listen to punk rock? Or does it matter at all? Because for me, it just always, it always made sense. Kid, had a pretty normal upbringing. I grew up in Park City, Utah. my parents had made just enough money for us to be broke around rich white folks. And I remember a lot of things. I remember a lot of good things. I didn't have a bad upbringing. I didn't necessarily have a bad home life. We're, you know, Generation X kids, and so that's a whole other bag, of course. But I do remember in elementary school and in middle school, I remember being sad. Depression runs in my family, and it skipped me, but I just have these stark memories about being sad and really struggling to figure out how to be happier. And even now, when I think back on it, like it doesn't really make any sense to me. I don't really understand why. But I remember it being there. I remember it being something that was pretty heavy. So I used to think a lot when I was young about relationships and girlfriends and all the things that like make up, I suppose, what I assumed is like a normal part of, you know, being a kid and having access to things. But I legitimately remember being kind of sad. I don't know if that reflected out. I don't know if my parents saw that or if my sister saw that, but I do remember being in some pretty dark places as a kid. I remember contemplating taking my own life several times. And of course it didn't happen, but I think that place of contemplation is still a dangerous place to be in and a tough place to be in. And I think back on that and I'm not exactly sure why I would think that. I mean, it could be because I look like this. I also remember being afraid of everything. I think I got that from my dad. My father was a fairly contentious man. He was a formidable man, a very hard man, as I remember as a kid. I remember just being deathly afraid of him at all costs, at every turn. Didn't want to make him mad. I didn't want to upset him. Frequently, when he'd come home, I'd be the first person to say, "Hi, Dad, how was your day?" And I think it was a preemptive strike. You know, I just didn't want to get yelled at. And was just trying to, you know, be happy and welcome my father home. Eventually, I started being drawn to other things. Eventually, I kind of got into a better place because I saw like skateboarding was becoming bigger, and then like I saw my first skate video, and then I saw like that they would put music in with the skate videos, and then that's like the first place that I started hearing a different kind of music, and it was really interesting to me and kind of exciting. I mean, probably more than that. This is teenage Gregg, and my cousin called me the other day because I posted this like as a throwback Thursday, and he's like, "My wife wants to know why you're posting thirst traps on." Going from that place where I wanted to, where I was sad and I wanted purpose, I wanted something to take my life, changed dramatically when I started finding purpose in other places. I wanted to skate, I wanted to listen to this music, and it was this process of discovery. I was thinking about like the first song that really kind of made an imprint on me, not maybe like the imprint, but certainly meant a lot to me, is this old Black Flag song. And the first time I heard it, I was just like, yeah, like that makes sense. And it was this place where it's like suddenly my feelings are being articulated, because when you're a teenager, you're just completely inarticulate. Like, how do you express emotions? And I'm in a house where like my mom and I talk a lot and we have a good relationship, but my dad and I don't. It's like completely inept, and so it kind of contributes to that place of like, you don't know what you can say, you don't know what you can't say, you don't know really how to communicate or talk. And so this music sort of gave me a voice, or I felt like I had a voice when really I just, you know, never really had a voice. But when I heard it, it just felt like my whole life had been saved. How crazy is that? But it's true. This is my mom and me. My dad used to take these beautiful photographs. My mom was kind of this cool character. Like, she was really into pop music, and it was everything from like the Doobie Brothers and Michael Jackson and David Bowie, and then it was like Prince and Tears for Fears and Crowded House. It was like all the good 80s pop, Hall & Oates. I secretly love Hall & Oates. No, I'll be walking in a department store with my wife, and you know, a Hall & Oates song will come on, and I just happen to know all the words, and it happens to embarrass the daughter. We were in this strange household. We grew up in a sort of Christian, non-denominational, like, my mom and I talked about this the other day. It's not evangelical, but it kind of felt that way. My father was from the South. He grew up in Chattanooga, Tennessee, so I think he kind of had that Southern Christian edge to it. But I remember it just being a pretty strict household. Like, we weren't allowed to play Dungeons and Dragons or play with the Ouija boards. Not that anybody should play with the Ouija board. And like, He-Man, we weren't allowed to watch He-Man or play with He-Man. And but like, and so it was like a conservative household, like it really was. And so it was this strange place where, like, I don't know who Skeletor is, but like, I know who Frankenfurter is, because my mom was super into the Rocky Horror Picture Show. I still don't understand that. But it's also like there's this culturally rich little place in there, right? Like, I shared the Rocky Horror Picture Show with Sage, who's 16, and Sage was like, oh, I know about this, it's crazy. And I said, yeah, it is kind of crazy, but also kind of beautiful. And she's like, yeah, it is kind of beautiful. And so I feel lucky to have had that, but also just mildly confused. Our household is pretty standard, you know? And I always think about that, you know, the influence of music, and especially my mom's taste. I mean, I played David Bowie for years in our house because I was looking for something that sounded good and was innocuous enough that, you know, didn't have the sort of words to come with the music I usually listen to. And so Sage's early memories of music are these David Bowie songs, and that, like, now Sage looks upon those like really fondly. Unfortunately, I lost my mom in 1991. It's an easy listening wears of Michael Bolden. I don't know if she ever truly recovered. But this was our house. This was our family. My poor father. First off, he looks like a hipster, but like the other thing is that he also looks like the stepdad who came in and like picked up this nice minority family, and he always hated that show. He was my dad, and I have some of his traits, but none of us really look like him. And my dad's influences on music were totally different. And it was like Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, and James Taylor, and Bob Dylan, and The Band, and Yes, and you know, Grateful Dead, and Neil Young, and it came out in the music that he played as well. In fact, my mom's music was always there, for sure, but I kind of always remember my dad's music, like, kind of being at the forefront, because we went camping a lot. Like, those were our summer vacations, and we had these mixes that we listened to, and it was music that my dad mostly liked, and some of what they shared, so, you know, there might be a little Rod Stewart in there. You know, but for the most part was that. And my dad, man, he was really angry when I was a kid. I think it was because I was born when he was 19. And I think in that time and place, like, there's this obligation that we feel, you know, like, I've had a kid, I have a family, and so I need to get a job and I need to do all the things. And like, you can't just go off and follow your dreams. You have to be practical and care and provide for a family. So my father was a car mechanic. I was a certified Volkswagen Porsche mechanic, and he learned how to do so at Intermountain Volkswagen here in Salt Lake City. I think it's still here. And that's what he did. And he was mad and he hated it. And those are the things that I remember most. But I also remember that he was like an artist. And I got into his old slides and stuff, and I started doing, I started scanning these old images. And I started finding these images that he took of my mom. And they're beautiful and kind of poetic and so simple. Like, holy hell, she looks so young. Looks like a child. My mom was 21 when I was born. It was my dad's first selfie. God, something else, such a weird looking dude. But he would have these simple images, like, what a simple image. You just took a picture of your Schwinn bicycle. But it looks incredible. But that's him. He was old enough to be a boomer, young enough to miss the draft. And I was actually thinking a lot about his music, and like, in my household, we have camping music, and it's basically like my dad's mix, right? And I was thinking about all of the aspects of my dad, like this old hippie, right? And how the music was really important, and he was always playing music, like on his guitar, or he was always listening to music, and what that meant to us, and that I think, For me, and I think also for my sister, that music was really important to us. Like, it was just this incredibly important thing to us. I have these memories of my mom putting a VHS tape into the VHS player and watching MTV and recording her favorite songs on the VHS and making like her own compilation, like a video compilation tape. And then she would put that in on a Saturday morning and play it and clean house. And I always thought that was so weird. But like, now it's not weird, right? We got Spotify, we got all these things, we can make playlists in like really special ways. I was thinking about the first song. Actually, a friend of mine asked me, what is the first song that made an impression on you? What's the first song that you felt like you connected with? And I was thinking long and hard about this, and you know, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young was just like clearly a very big influence on my father, and he made music that you can hear pieces of it in there, and I was thinking about like all of that, and I actually landed on the idea that this song Ohio is it. And it's kind of incredible because if you know anything about me and you know what I do, there is sort of an activist edge. I mean, I reject that a little bit. I would call myself a disruptor. Far before I would call myself an activist, but like, there is that sort of ethos. And then I was thinking about this song, Ohio, and that it's a protest song, and how appropriate it is that like, this is the song that I really remember as a kid, that this protest song came from that, and what that sort of, I think, inadvertently had an effect on me.
Soldiers and Nixon coming, we're finally on our
this idea that censorship is something that seems to pop up in my life from time to time. I guess it happens when you're pushing buttons and disrupting spaces. I had an opportunity to show at a group show at the Smithsonian in 2016, and it was this kind of incredible opportunity. It was a group show, it was on Memorial Weekend in 2016, and there was like 40 plus artists for this show. It was a pop-up show, so it was just on for the weekend. And it was this incredible opportunity. But if you don't know how the Smithsonian works, because I lived in DC for about almost 17 years, and I worked for the Smithsonian right out of college as well. I worked for the National Museum of American Indians, and it was this strange thing where all the different museums, like the Air and Space Museum, the Natural History Museum, National Gallery of Art, the Hirshhorn, like each museum has its own director, its own set of curators, and they're sort of under this umbrella of the Smithsonian. So we were working with the Asian Pacific American Center, and they got this grant. They got a huge grant from the Ford Foundation, and in fact, I heard it was the biggest grant the Ford Foundation has ever given to the Smithsonian, which has to have been sizable because they give a lot of money to the Smithsonian. And they wanted to take their idea of doing a pop-up exhibit in the Arts and Industry Building, which is right next to the Smithsonian Castle. And it was built in the 1800s. And they wanted to, like, wanted them to expand it so that it sort of included beyond their representative region. And so I got called into this, and I was very excited about it. But the upper echelon of the Smithsonian and was really concerned about this, and actually brought it in the Board of Regents to turn into this whole fiasco. So they insisted that the curator come in and show every artist, or give them like less than 24 hours notice. Like, you have to come here, you need to show all the artists that are participating, what they propose to do. And so they did that, and as he did that, they had a problem with two artists. They had a problem with this one artist. Her name is Anita Ali, and she's this Cambodian Muslim woman, and she wanted to do a piece that was about, like, can a Muslim American be a patriot? And if you remember, in 2016, there was sort of demonization of Muslims happening during a presidential campaign, so it seemed very timely and very interesting. And then the other artist was me. And he told me, the curator told me, that when he showed them my work, he showed them my very first performance piece, which is called The Last American Indian on Earth. And when he showed them an image, he said there was an audible gasp in the room. And I said, why? And he said, I don't know. So he showed him a couple pieces, and like this, the entire piece is I'm wearing a fake Indian outfit, right? The headdress, like everything's like made in China. And it was all about exploiting how much Americans don't know about Native people. So the whole purpose of it was to wear this thing and to go into public and to document the way that people would react and interact with me, which, I gotta tell you, Americans really stepped it up, man. They did not disappoint. This being a great example, this gentleman, this is not a stage photograph. He wanted to point it at his Cleveland Indians hat and take a picture of me. But I might have been pushing some buttons. You might remember this one along the way. And really, I just, this whole piece was about having fun. And all I could gather is that maybe, just maybe, the Board of Regents gasped because they knew what cultural appropriation was, but they didn't realize I can't appropriate myself. And so, like, maybe that's the problem. But there became a lot of concern. They were worried about what I was going to say and how I was going to say it. Like, what was I going to do to address this? And they preemptively told me, like, you can't talk about the Washington Redskins, which is, like, weird because it wasn't part of my original piece. But I was one of many faces at the front of that discussion when that was sort of at its peak. And so they must have known who I was, but, like, I don't know. I didn't understand. So they said, I can't talk about the Washington Redskins. I can't use the insignia, I can't use the logo, I'm not even allowed to say the name. And I think it's because they're one of the biggest donors to that museum. So a bit of a cash cow, so that maybe is part of it. But then they were like, well, we're concerned because there's a performance piece attached to this exhibition, and we're concerned about what you're going to say and how you're going to say it. And I said, at this point, it's like ridiculous. And I was like, well, I wonder if I can get away with this. So I said, I have a suggestion. And they said, great. I said, I can bring in a cultural interpreter. And they said, what's a cultural interpreter? I said, it's a white man that follows me around everywhere and informs everything that I'm saying in the way that I'm saying it. And they said, they stopped. They thought for a second. And they said, that's great. Let's do that. So, my friend Jeremy, his hair was just long enough he could do a sad little man bun. He wore glasses. He had a blazer with pads on elbows. He was like a real anthropologist. He had a name tag on that I had made for him. It said Cornelius Smith, cultural interpreter. And we turned this into a performance piece. So the performance piece was that anytime I addressed anybody, anytime anyone asked me a question, I would give an honest and meaningful answer to Jeremy. They could hear me, of course. And then he would tell them what I had just said. Except everything he said was wrong. So somebody's like, hey, what do you think about the Washington Redskins? And I would go into this discourse of, you know, why it's inappropriate. And the term Redskin is a racial slur. It literally means the proof of Indian kill. And going on and giving this whole thing. And then he would tell them, he really likes their colors. And that's it. We did this all weekend, actually, because there's a food truck on the National Mall, so like we'd leave the building, we'd go to the food truck, and we'd get food, and so I would say what I wanted, and then Jeremy would tell them what I wanted, but he always ordered the wrong thing, so I never got what I wanted. We did it for the whole weekend, and it was funny, and it was sad, and it was all the things. My original piece was to just buy the biggest TV I could find and to fill it with IKEA furniture. I wanted to call it Modern Indigenous Living. But it ended up turning into this whole other thing where I filled the entire TV up with paintings that were taken from paintings that I made that were using like old photographs from Edward Curtis from the turn of the century. Photographer who famously took probably all those black and white relic images you've seen were done by Edward Curtis, or as I like to say, Ed Curtis, were on a casual basis. And so Ed Curtis was famous for not just taking these pictures, but he was famous for setting the pictures up and bringing his own costumes. It's like, oh, you don't look Indian enough. Here's the headdress. This is how he did his work. And so I did these paintings that were based on that. And the Smithsonian was like, that's great. Like, because I gave them something that was familiar to them, but I didn't tell them that I would deface every single painting during the performance. So I would put big red X's over their mouths. The piece was called The Indian Voice Removal Act of 1879 to 2016. 1879 is when boarding schools started. And I saw that as like the first real concerted effort to take away the voice of Native people to 2016. And they had no idea. The show was called Crosslines, a culture lab on intersectionality, and it was really about how diverse the group of artists were, and what they were creating, and how they were creating it, and just the dialogues were happening in it. And so Anita and I, the other artists that was sort of flagged, we became very close friends because we were having a shared experience of just outright censorship. For Anita, they kept getting upset about her ideas. So she'd present a different idea, and they would be like, that's worse than the first one. Like, are you messing with us? And they really weren't. Her whole idea was to just be on a stage surrounded by American flags. She wanted to do some things to the American flags, just sort of as a symbol, like turn them upside down, which is a symbol of distress that they do. That's what they teach you in the military. And they just said no, and eventually landed on this place where they wouldn't allow us to speak. They said, you can participate, you can be in this space, but you're not allowed to talk to the people that are there, to the patrons that come through. In 2016, the Smithsonian, which gets its money, at least half its money, from the federal government, told a Muslim artist, you're not allowed to speak. I tried my best to get her to get that contract taken. Kinko's blow it up, make it part of the installation. But there's also a lot of fear in there, right? Because if you step out of line, you're not getting paid. All of us are putting forth our own money to make this happen in hopes that we're going to get reimbursed by everything. And if we are breached a contract, well, then we don't get paid. So Nina and I decided that we were going to intersect, right? It's a cultural intersectionality. And so we decided we were going to intersect. She came into my space. I went into her space. The Arts and Industry building is a big X, and at the apex of it is a fountain. And they built a stage there, and she was all these American flags surrounding, about 100 of them. And I got into her space, and it turned into this whole thing that just was suddenly really beautiful and kind of poignant and purposeful. And it was like history and shared experiences and perception and patriotism and nationalism and all of these things. We decided to call this existence as protest. And it lasted for 6 minutes until I was forcibly removed from the stage. Censorship is this place of fear, and fear begets fear, which is why I was forcibly removed from the stage. I didn't know that Board of Regents and the Office of Public Affairs had threatened the director of the organization we were working with that if me or Annette stepped out of line, she and all the curators were going to lose their job. So they forcibly removed me from the stage in front of a lot of people. For 2 days, this show was out, and there was over 50,000 people came through those doors. It was busy. We managed to get this picture. Someday we'll get to finish it. As you know, it's really interesting. In 1984 or 1985, there was a congressional hearing going on. It was all about censorship, and it was about music, like, you know, that same old sort of conservative discussion about, like, music are affecting our children, movies are affecting our children. But at this time, it was this discussion about music, and this is where the censorship, like, lyrics sticker came from that they used to sell on CDs and tapes and things back in the 80s and in the 90s. And during this congressional hearing, Tipper Gore was like in charge of it, and they asked Dee Snider to come talk. And Dee Snider was the lead singer of Twisted Sister. And if you've seen Dee Snider, like, especially in that time and era, his hair is teased up, they wear makeup, they wear like tight, sort of women-esque clothes, which apparently was controversial. I mean, New York Dolls did it like a decade before that, but whatever. And so they asked Dee Snider to come down and to testify. And really, they're setting it up, right? They're setting it up because they're bringing this guy in here that they think is an idiot, and he's going to come in, and he's just going to prove their point. And it turns out that Dee Snider can put a couple sentences together. And he took them to task, calling out Tipper Gore. What was so interesting about that whole thing, and really what's interesting about censorship, what's interesting about fear that is sort of associated with it, is just the congressional hearing just kept talking about sex and violence and sex and violence. And Dee Snider was like, it's not my job to watch your kids, that's like your job. But they kept talking about sex and violence. I mean, they exploited a song called Sex and Violence, so maybe that's correct. Maybe it is correct. I was asked, by the same friend that asked me what song I connected with, you can send a song into space, what song would you send? And I said, Sex and Violence by the Exploited, because that's pretty much all we're doing here. She could see my laptop. She's like, what are you doing? This is my wife and I, me about probably 60 pounds ago. My wife legitimately looks exactly the same. We were married in 1999 in Washington, D.C., and I like to joke with her that I have photographic evidence that she used to adore me once. We were just kids when we were doing this, you know? My wife, like, I wouldn't be here, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing if it wasn't for her, because she helped me, and as she supported me, and then ultimately believed in me. When I left school, Megan was like, what do you want to do? And I said, I want to be an artist. And she's like, try again. Like, she wanted me to pick something a little more practical, something that would make money, because, you know, we want to have a family at some point. And so I did that, and it didn't go well. I tried. I gave it a good try. Eventually, the recession sort of flushed me out of the workforce, and then I started concentrating on artwork, and I started concentrating on making work, and then like hustling out the house, because we were in the recession in 2008 and 2009, and it carried to 2010, and I was just trying to figure it out. And there was a point where the artwork, making artwork, actually became more practical than trying to find a job. And that was okay, and Megan trusted me and carried me through that. She's a tough woman. Like, she's such a good example to my kids. She's a good example to my boys that it's okay to be with and align yourself with a strong, independent woman. She's a good example to my girls, because she is just a strong and independent woman, and I just feel so incredibly fortunate to have her. She doesn't listen to the music I listen to. She listens to what I deem like early 2000s crab rock. but my wife, you know, she really is just everything. And I just feel so incredibly lucky to have her. I have to be honest, it'll be a cold day in hell before I let my kids rock their head to Nickelback. Like, it's just not happening. I took Sage to their first show in 2018. We went and saw the Misfits original lineup with Danzig and the Distillers and the Damned and the Cro-Mags. And that was Sage's first show. And I did it for two reasons. One, because I really wanted to go. I really wanted to see the show, of course. But I also did it for bragging rights, that Sage could tell everybody for the rest of her days that her first concert was the Misfits. So this is working. So, it was kind of interesting growing up in Park City, because it wasn't what we would call diverse. It's Utah, you know? And I asked my mom once, I said, why Park City, Utah? And my mom was like, it's more diverse. And like, you know, one black kid and one Jewish girl and like a handful of Mexicans. Like, this is not the most diverse place that you could be. But we had access to things. It was strange. Like, we weren't necessarily poor, but like, we weren't rich either. And so it was a strange place, because you have access to like privilege, like skiing and snowboarding, but like, we were still, you know, scraping by to get name brand shoes if we could get that. When I really started hanging out with, this one kid in particular. His name was Coleman. And Coleman and I became really good friends. And we used to skate together, and we used to hang out. I'd stay the night at his house, and then we'd watch Yo MTV Raps, And then we'd stay up till midnight on a Saturday night, watch headbangers ball, because sometimes you get a little bit of punk, you get a little bit of metal. And you know, we used to hang out all the time. We used to have night terrors, we used to scare the hell out of me. He'd wake up in the middle of the night like, I'm gonna kill you, and then just like, what? No, you know. He had a good home, a good family, and he was a good kid, he was my friend. And I went to my first big concert. My mom and my dad took me to see Arlo Guthrie at the University of Utah. I don't really count that as my first concert. My first concert was Public Enemy. And they played in the Salt Palace with Anthrax. And it was all these like hair band rocker guys there for Anthrax. And it was like all this small group of like skate kids that were there for Public Enemy. And we totally thought we were going to our asses kicked, but like it was the best. It was the best. It was really the best. I worked at this place called Devonza's in Park City, pretty much all through high school. And it was run by these like really angry Irish Catholic guys from the East Coast, from the Northeast Coast. It's the first place I ever had somebody say the F word to me in total and complete anger. And I learned a lot that day. I was working there when I was a senior in high school, and it was this one evening, and Coleman rolled up with a couple other people in the car with them. At this point, Coleman and I are still friends, and we still talk. We're not spending as much time together. He's diversifying his friend group. And we were going to shows and stuff. Like, I was going to shows, and he was going to shows, and sometimes he was going with other people, and that was fine. Like, I could see that he was kind of going out, but we were still friends, and I still really think fondly of him, you know, in that time and place. And he came by, and he's like, hey, said, we're going to go see Rage Against the Machine. They're playing with House of Pain, and you should come with us. And I was like, oh, man, I'm working. And he's like, oh, you should skip work and come with us. And I was like, no, I gotta do this. And he's like, all right. He said, well, it was good seeing you, man. I was like, it's good seeing you too. It was like, have fun. And he's like, all right, I'll catch you later. And that was the last time I saw Coleman. He had a heart condition. He was 16 and went to the show and had a heart attack and he died. And yeah, that kind of messed me up. And it definitely messed me up. I don't really know that I was able to listen to Rage Against the Machine the same after that. It was just this heavy, heavy time.
Yes, I dwell in hell, but it's a hell that I can grip. Try to grip my family, but I slipped. To escape from the pain, in an existence mundane. I've got a night, a sign, a set, and now I got a name. Read my writing on the wall. No one's gonna catch me when I fall.
Going to shows. There was this core group of people in our high school, like maybe six or seven, and then a couple of stragglers that sort of rolled solo. But like, I was friendly with them, but I wasn't friends with them. I didn't hang out with them. I didn't go to shows with them. And I don't remember how I started going to these like hardcore, you know, punk straight edge shows. I remember just being obsessed with it all the time. I remember doing a lot of things, and I had these like these odd friends that certainly didn't look the part, and they didn't skate or anything like that, but they were always down to go, and so we would go. And I didn't drive. I didn't get my license until I was like 18, because there was public transportation, and I had friends who could drive, so I would just roll with somebody else when we go to shows. There was a show that came up. It was there was a big buzz about it. It was the Inside Out reunion show. So Inside Out was Zach De La Rocha, the lead singer of Rage Against the Machine, and a whole hardcore band. And so Inside Out came. I knew who Inside Out was. And I heard their music, but I didn't know any of the records. So I didn't really know any of their songs. But I know the buzz about the show was big, and everybody was excited. And so we go to the show. And I actually found a video of this on YouTube of the show, and I saw the back of my head in the crowd. It was a raised stage, and there was these two goons standing on either side because they had to make sure nobody jumps on the stage to, you know, stage dive or whatever. And so there was no stage diving, but there was still crowd surfing. People were still getting up on the crowd, and kind of moving around, and the energy was high, and everything was fantastic, and. There was just a lot of people there. And I remember I got up on the crowd and I was on my back, but like if I had sat up, my back would have been facing the stage. So I was like on my back upside down, and we hit a chorus point in the song, and I was like moving closer up to the stage, and then Zach took out the microphone and he put it in my face, like, for the chorus, and I didn't know the words. And I think I said something like, and I know it's a brief moment, like, this is probably something Zach wouldn't even remember, but I remember this momentary, like, he just looked so disappointed, and how embarrassed I was, and I got down, and I was sort of defeated, and I went over to my friends, and they're like, man, that was awesome, and I'm like, and it was this moment of awkwardness, but like that moment of awkwardness is also sort of perfect, right? But the energy of the space is like, even now still when I think about it, even now like as I'm more familiar with Inside Out now, that the music still has like this, it still has this pull, this sort of vibe attached to it, and I want to share that with you guys. This show in a theater in Dallas, and it was like this little theater, and there was all these people that were that were older, and they were hearing this music and they were like, sorry. After Coleman died, well, it was sort of a perfect storm. I did terrible in high school. Things were not looking good. My mom and my dad were tired of me. It was 100% my fault. I was not participating. I was not doing homework. I was not doing what I was supposed to be doing. All I was doing was skating and drawing and going to shows and snowboarding in the off season from skateboarding. That's all I did. And everything was coming to a head. I was 17. And when Coleman died, I didn't know how to handle it. I didn't really know how to cycle it. And at the same time, my dad's like, hey, you should move out of the house. I talked to my brother, my Uncle John, and you could move to Tennessee, and you could be with John, and you could just kind of get a new start and kind of figure out how to get things in. And I was not healthy. I was not doing well. I wasn't figuring out how to cycle anything that was happening to me. And I said, okay. And so I didn't go to Coleman's funeral. I didn't talk to anybody. I just got on a Greyhound bus and I left. I was in Tennessee for about 6 months before my uncle got very sick of me and said, you need to go home. And I went home, and by this time I'm 18 years old, I take the Greyhound back home, and my dad lays down the wall, right? He gives me the business. He's like, you need to get a job, you need to get your license, you need to get a car, you need to come up with a plan, because at that point I had dropped out of high school, so you need to get a GED. And so I said, okay, and so the day I went and got my job back, I drove down to Heber, which was where the you could take a driver's test, and I got my driver's test, I got my license that day. My dad was a car mechanic, right? So there's this thing that happens in places like Park City where speedboats come into town, and they bring these cars, and then they like leave the title and the keys on the seat and abandon the car, and then they end up just towing the car to my dad's shop. And so he had these cars. He was like, okay, you can choose between one of these two cars. And one was a canary yellow Cadillac Eldorado. Not a nice Eldorado, like an 80s Eldorado. And the inside was canary yellow leather interior. I was like, the other one, you guys see National Lampoon's Vacation? It was the Ford Country Squire. It had a V8, wood panels, and that was my car. That was my first car. And so I got the car, and I got the job, and I was working, and I think that my father was starting to trust me a little bit, and I had a weekend where I went away. And I went with some friends, and we went to a show. I think we went and saw Rancid and Bad Religion and Green Day. Pre-Dookie at the Salt Lake Fairgrounds, which I don't think exists anymore. And when we were there, my friend's like, I have a friend who has a tattoo gun. And I said, that's cool, let's go see your friend. And I went, and I got my first tattoo. It was just on my arm right here. And it was this interesting situation because I got home and things were pretty casual. I had a day off. It was a Sunday, I remember. And I was wearing a white t-shirt, and we had this big L-shaped couch, right? And on either end of the couch are like recliners. I don't know, do they even make those anymore? And my mom's on one side, my dad's on the other side, and I'm laying on the floor looking up at the television. My hands are behind my head, and the sleeve of my arm like comes down, and my mom sees it. We weren't supposed to get tattoos, right? We're in this strict religious home. It wasn't very strict when I got into high school, but like for some reason those things were still there, and I don't know, Leviticus says something. And so my mom sees it and she goes, what's that on your arm? And I sit up and I push my sleeve down and I go, nothing. And she goes, is it a tattoo? And I said, yeah. And my mom said, let me see it. And I could just see the disappointment on her face. I show her the tattoo. And my dad said, let me see it. This one's going to be harsher because my father's scary. And so I go over to him and I show him. And he just sighs really loudly. And he goes, son, are you stupid or do you just not give a shit? I was like, I feel like there's a third option, Dad. My oldest son is 13, and he's in what I call his stand-up comedian phase, where he's testing boundaries, and he's trying to be funny, and he's trying to say, he's like funny like 1 out of 10 times. And not a fan of this stage, and but he just keeps doing it. He's goofy, and it's funny, but it's not funny. And for the first time in my life, I can understand exactly what my dad felt. I'm like, oh, yeah. That, my dad said, pack your stuff, I want you out by Friday. And I said, okay, I'm 18 at this point. When on the Thursday before I'm supposed to be out, and I had already secured a place to stay, and I had already packed my stuff, and my dad took me to Mount Airy Cafe, which I don't think is there anymore in Park City. It's like a low budget Denny's. And so we go and he buys me breakfast and he's like, listen, you don't have to go. You can stay. But this is what's gonna happen is you're gonna go to work and you're gonna come home. And you're not gonna go out, you're not gonna do anything. You're gonna study and you're gonna get that GED so that you can make some choices. we're going to run a strict household, and you're going to do X, Y, and Z. Like, in my mind, he's creating an impossible situation for me. Like, I'm obviously going to say no. And then he says, well, whatever decision you make, it's your decision. I didn't kick you out. Like, you're making a decision. Years later, I had an opportunity to talk to him about this and just told him how full of shit I thought he was in that moment. And he's like, that's fair. I look back at these things and I think it's so interesting and I think it's so strange, and I feel fortunate that my dad and I were able to actually later on talk about these things and sort of work these things out. But I can't really be that mad, because if all these things hadn't happened the way that they happened, I don't know that I would be here doing what I'm doing. I wouldn't be the person that I am, because I wouldn't have had that experience. Now, I would never do that to my own kids, but, you know, it is what it is, and that's okay.
Someday, we'll come back and laugh.
Song that really connected with me, and a song that I heard when I was a teenager that I'm like, yeah, that's it. That's saying the words. It's this old Rollins Band song after Henry Rollins left Black Flag. He put his own band together called Rollins Band. On his first album, Name of Silence, he did this song called No Self Opinion, and I was like, yeah, that's about all those people that I know that, you know, suck. I think it was mostly about me, but it spoke like his emotion. Anger is emotion, right? So it's emotion, but it's also like it's articulating something that is in a way that just really spoke to me at the time, and was kind of surprised by that. I thought it was just incredibly interesting. Rollins Band. No self-opinion. Nothing, like I'm good, like I'm a grown man, I don't need presents, and She's like, well, you were talking about a turntable. And I was like, yeah, no. And she's like, you should just get the turntable. And then I had this strange existential crisis, right? I figured out between the time that I was 17 and the time that I got married when I was 24, that I had moved no less than 26 or 27 times. And that there was this significant lack of permanence in my life. And that when my wife and I got married, I really felt that still. And then after a year, we bought a house. And we lived in a house for almost 15 years, and I never unpacked. And it wasn't a reflection on her. It wasn't even really a reflection on our relationship. It was just this sort of fight or flight sort of thing that I had been conditioned for. Like, you don't know when you're going to have to leave. And so the turntable's like, well, if we get a turntable and I buy a bunch of records, then we'll be able to move all the records somewhere. Like, well, we've had some financial troubles in the past. And like, what if I can only buy two records? And like, how stupid is that? Like, I have a whole turntable, two records. I'm just spiraling, and my wife's like, bro, just get the turntable. It's okay. And I kind of began to recognize that there was something systemic happening. That there was this lack of permanence. And my wife, knowingly or unknowingly, gave me permission. Like, yeah, you should go, you should do this. And so I started sort of diving into it. And I started like working through it. And there was a whole bunch of things happening at the same time. Like that work with the comic book series and the punk rock lyrics, like that came out of this moment. This incredible moment of letting go of this lack of permanence and trusting where I am. Trusting that I'm a grown adult and I have children and I have a wife and like everything's okay. And I never stopped listening to it, but that I could engage this music in a way that I did when I was a kid. That I could buy records and I could listen for stuff and I could go through the process and I sort of reasserted myself through the process of like taking a record out of the sleeve and you know, maybe blowing on it because it has a little bit of dust and placing it on the turntable and pressing the button and watching the arm go over and drop down onto the record and then realizing you have it on the wrong setting because that song's not that fast and you change the setting and you listen to it 15 minutes later it stops and you have to get up and you have to turn the record over and it's this analog process that is kind of beautiful and it interrupts my day because I'm in the middle of doing something, but getting up and standing over and turning the record over, like that's not such a bad thing, that's okay. And Sage started seeing what I was doing, and Sage wanted to turn tables, started collecting records and doing the same thing. And the Phoenix slide, he started doing the same thing. I started buying records like that I used to have. There's this one record in particular, it's by this band called Circle Jerks. I don't know if you know what Circle Jerks is. And the record's called Group Sex. And I remember having this and hiding it from my mom and my dad, remember, a conservative religious household, and being scared to death that they would find out I had this record by a band called Circle Jerks called Group Sex. I was thinking back on it because I got a first pressing of this for my record collection and I was just so excited about it. And I was kind of chuckling to myself because like the things that I would hide from my parents because I just thought that they would be so mad. And to be honest, like now I pretty much know that like I don't think my mom would have cared. But maybe we'd ask questions, but you might really wouldn't care. It took Sage to see the Circle Jerks this year. And it was a terrifying show. It reminded me of the old days, it was fantastic. I don't know how into it Sage was. Well, 7 Seconds was there and Negative Approach was there. And if you have the opportunity to Google that Negative Approach, because the lead singer is terrifying looking. I'm like, is that his face? It's his face. How interesting this thing traverses generations and traverses space. They're like, I have two children who are like, yeah, can I get a Circle Jerk? And just how incredible that is. And I was thinking about a song from that album that stuck out to me, and I actually came up with like what I think is the most angsty song that they do. So Circle Jerks. the world at my ass.
Got the world at my ass, and I'm gonna jump down. Me the first, come in the last. I've got the world up my ass.
Still sounds exactly the same, and still angsty. He's like a 60-something-year-old angsty man, which I think is hysterical. This is my father. I think I mentioned that he was a pretty hard man. He was a musician. This guy, man, he was deaf in one ear. He could hear something once and just play it. And didn't teach me anything. I always hated that. We didn't get along for a long time. I hated my dad when I was a kid. And I hated him because I thought he hated me. And I really struggled with that. And of course, that's confirmed by friends. My friend Ben used to come over and he was just like, man, your dad's kind of a dick. I always hated that. Because like sons want to connect with their father. We used to do these things where my dad, was a car mechanic, and so on the weekends we would work on people's cars in the parking lot of the apartment complex we lived in, which is next to the high school. And on the weekends we would fix cars, and we would have him come out and hand him tools. We'd sit out there for hours, and he wouldn't say a word to me. He wouldn't say anything. He used to drive me crazy. So I would just try to fill the space by talking. He was just concentrating on whatever he was concentrating on, and we never talk. The only time he would talk is if I handed him the wrong tool, and usually he was yelling, not talking. I think it was tough for him because I reminded him so much of himself. But I also remember, like, my father was 19 years old when I was born. My mom was 21. And this is a child trying to have a baby, trying to raise a baby. I guess I feel lucky that at least he felt responsible enough for that to stick with it, and he did. He did the best he could, but the best you can when you're 19 or 20 years old is questionable. My dad used to ask me, he'd be like, when I started gaining a little bit of notoriety with my work and doing activism things, he'd be like, how come you don't tell anybody you're half white? I'd be like, because clearly my father is white, my mom is full blood, is where our native blood comes from. So we're in this dynamic now, right? My dad said, well, how come you don't tell people that you're half white? And I was like, well, Dad, it doesn't really come up. He's like, well, I think you should tell people. I was like, well, Dad, I wear white clothes, I speak English, and I live in a Western house. I don't know how much more white you want me to be. And he was like, okay. Like, he was smart enough to be reasonable. It was really funny because my father was like really good at arguing. I think my mom stopped arguing with him a long, long time ago. And I reached this point where I had an argument with him as an adult, and like I won the argument. And it's like, yes. And of course, now I'm in a place where my poor mom doesn't argue with me probably for the same reasons. Should have argued with my dad. My ability to speak, my ability to do the things that I do, I get from my father. He was a talker. He talked all the time. He told stories. In fact, our whole family speaks in this weird way of just telling stories all the time. He spent enough time with us, we'll tell you a story or two or ten. And it's just the way that we have always communicated. My dad got cancer. He had it for 2 years and was doing treatments, and he was stage four, and so the treatments were like just enough to kind of stave off things, but quality of life is definitely a tough one. And in 2015, in April, my grandfather, my father's father, passed away. He had Alzheimer's, and so if I remember correctly, it was the end of one of his treatments, and he would do about 2 weeks in between his treatment and start it all over again. And he was at the end of that 2 weeks, and he went to Tennessee to be with his family, our family. And at the end of that 2 weeks, his mom, my father was a favorite, his mom asked him to stay a little longer. And so he did. And he came home after that, and they ran tests, and everything had spread. Just 1 week, everything had spread. And he was terminal. I got a call from my sister, and she said, you need to get down here and see Dad. And I was in the middle of finishing up a mural in Washington, D.C., like right on Capitol Hill. And I got a call from my sister, and she's just like, yeah, it's not good. Like, you need to come home. So I came home. Oh, I was so frustrated because I thought that I was flying out of Dulles. There's two airports in Washington, D.C. There's Washington Dulles in Virginia. There's the National Airport that's right across the river of the Potomac River, across from D.C. So I get to Dulles, and I find out that my ticket was in the wrong airport. And I missed my flight. I lost almost a day of being here to spend time with my dad. I was just crushed. But I did. I made it. My dad, towards the end of this, like, we're not sure what happened. Everything, like, affected his throat. I mean, insult to injury, the man that talks can't talk. You couldn't even hear a whisper. And so he would just sit silently, and he would just listen. And you could see the frustration in his face. But I got there and spent time with him. I kind of knew that was going to be the last time I saw him. I've known this guy my whole life. I've never seen him tear up or cry, ever. He was always just, like, such a man, you know? As we're about to leave, I hug my father. And these words came out of my mouth that even I wasn't expecting. I said, you're the most important man in my life. I had no idea. Till that exact moment, I had no idea. I was so fortunate to be able to take all of that hate and anger and angst from when I was a kid and bridge that before he got sick. Like, what an incredible blessing. We didn't have to do a bedside reconciliation. We did it. We had those hard conversations. He used to get these, you know, infusions, and those were always the worst. And then he would call me in the middle of the night, and he would talk to me, and I think he started realizing that we were a lot alike. And that he could complain about something, and I'd be like, yeah, that would annoy me too. And I think it helped connect him to those things. I went to a record store a couple years ago, and I found this record. It's a Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young record, and it's white, it's Far Away. And I was going through and listening to it, and, you know, listening to my dad's old music is a little bit of abusive. It's abusive to myself because you just get emotional about it. I came across this song, and I was just like, yeah, it felt like my dad. Thank you.
freedom buried in the ground. Mother Earth will swallow you, lay your body down. Find the cost of freedom buried in the ground. Mother Earth will swallow you, lay your body down.
So this work that I mentioned to you, I started in 2019, and it was just strange because I had been going through all this music, right, and I'm trying to find all this stuff, and recognizing that, like, the music and kind of reconciling that in the way that I was doing was, like, very healing. I was able to let go of a lot, feel a little healthier, a little more stable, a little more myself. And so I started making this work, and it was received really well. I put it on Instagram, and, you know, a couple of famous people bought some. Like, it was awesome. I was really excited about it. And I found, like, some really amazing songs. This is from a band called Minutemen, and the song's called Punchline. It says, I believe when they found the body of General George A. Custer quilled like a porcupine with Indian arrows, he didn't die with any honor, any dignity, or any valor. How perfect is that, right? But it's also about the way that certain words exist. This is from an Interrupters song. The word sacred ground stuck out to me. Make our home in this sacred ground. We've been here for years, solid in foundation, the blood, the sweat, the tears. Raise your voice, stand side by side, and we will sing forever. We don't have much, but we've got each other. And so, this work is up, right? And I'm talking to a friend of mine who runs a very large contemporary arts center, and we want to do a show. We've got to figure this out. And then COVID hits, and everything shuts down. And I sat in this work for years, waiting for something to come about. I have a repeat slide there, sorry. And I was able to start spreading this stuff around. This is in downtown Denver. I mean, this is a few stories tall. This is a large piece. And it's just this exciting thing. And while consumable on the outset, like, it seems like it's pretty easy, low-hanging fruit, right? And you get it, you understand it, you're like, I don't even have to explain it, you get it, right? And yet it still has this deep-seated thing connected to me, to my own journey, to my own ideas, to my own experiences, and it's super exciting. This is also tied into this other thing. I got a grant for this performance piece to expand it. The idea, because I had done this original performance piece in February 2020, and then I got this grant, and then everything shut down, right? And so now I can't do the performance piece again, but the grant's supposed to expand it so I can make, like, some original music to sort of accompany this, that maybe those bridges can have something that's a little more personal, or even more personal, as it were. And we worked on it for a couple of years because, like, trying to do music over Zoom doesn't work. Like, it's a whole vibe. You gotta be in the same room as each other. And so I was getting really frustrated with it. So then I went to this residency in Florida in October of last year. It was a mentor residency, and I was the mentor, which I was like, all right, is this where I am in my career? And so I have six artists I'm working with, and there's a musician, and he has six artists he's working with, and then there's a poet, and he has six poets that he's working with. And one of the musicians is the lead guitarist for this band called Algiers. And they're not super well-known, but well-known enough. You know, they're actually on their fourth record now, and And so he was like, yeah, I was really excited about this residency because I was really excited to meet you. Maybe we can do a collaboration. I was like, yeah. So I have the same thing I've been trying to do, is just like figure out a way to do spoken word, but like with punk riffs, as opposed to, you know, like ambiance or jazz. And I gave him some examples, and he's like, yeah, this is really cool. And I was like, well, I wrote this thing yesterday in about an hour, and it was this like way too long spoken word piece. It's just called Bad Indian, and it was just about like being a Native person and how everything, every time you do something that you're not supposed to do or it was perceived as not supposed to do, that that just makes you a bad Indian. He's like, that's awesome. And so he pulled in a drummer, and he played bass with a distortion. I had my wife send out a distortion pedal that just sounds super unique. A sound that you can get with probably three pedals, but I have one pedal that does this sound. And so we used that with the bass, and we just laid it out, and we figured out what we were going to do and how we were going to do it, and we practiced it like three times, and then we pressed record, and then that's it. And so I accidentally put a band together, and it's called The Dead Pioneers, and it is everything that I want to do. And listen, I'm not going to be famous. I'm not going to tour either. My wife would just murder me. But I have five kids. Like, that's just too long. But the medium is so exciting. It's so much fun. We actually got in the studio together. Like, we pulled everybody together and in August. And we did the first day just practicing. We gotta figure out these songs. I had six songs by the time we were done in one day, original songs. And then I had COVID and quit. We're set to record in January, like we're gonna do this in January. And I'm stoked about it. But I wanna share this with you because everything that I've been talking about, everything that we've been doing has led to this moment of being able to show this one song, this one thing, The Dead Pioneers, Bad Indian.
Not a very good Indian, maybe even a bad Indian. My cheekbones aren't high enough, I don't have enough beadwork or turquoise. I do my best to celebrate November like a month-long birthday for Indians. For those of you who don't know, which is probably most of you, it's a National Native American Heritage Month, and unfortunately celebrating feels like I'm celebrating my birthday by myself. No one seems to know that it's even happening, even with all the Facebook notices. And I'm a bad Indian. Someone tells me that that their great-great-grandmother was a Cherokee princess, I immediately want to dismantle what they're saying. After I roll my eyes. But there are no Cherokee princesses, there are no Native American monarchies. And then I'm a bad Indian for wanting to dismantle their blood mess, when you're the one who taught me to dismantle in the first place. Something that I learned through my genetic memory and through my personal memory. And I'm just a bad Indian.
Thank you.